if nothing else scares us into destroying the strongholds in our lives, then seeing them in our loved ones should. Jacob didn't have to keep bargaining with God. He didn't have to do that. He just didn't have to. But for some reason, he did. Really, Jacob? His promises aren't enough for you? You have to see it. You have to wear it. You have to taste it. It's just so wrong. Jacob is saying, in effect, God has to show me. Then I'll pick him as my God. Jacob doesn't have it settled. Jacob knows about God. Jacob has met with God. Jacob has had some experiences with God. But Jacob has some things to settle. And they're not settled yet. The strongholds are still standing. They're showing up in his decisions. Bargaining with God. Check this one. Jacob didn't have to keep neglecting his family either. This part is remarkable to me. Now, keep in mind that Abraham was told that his descendants were going to be like the sands by the seashore. Ever try to count a handful of sand, let alone a whole beach? And in generation two, he has exactly one descendant, Isaac. In generation three, Esau's out. It's just going to be Jacob. But as you probably know, Jacob is the one who ended up with 12 sons that became the beginning of the fulfillment of the promise. However, how it plays out is quite a bit less exciting. Start in chapter 29, verse 31, and go all the way over to chapter 30, verse 24. And there you have the story of the birth of the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, I'm not going to read all of that to you, but I can tell you that it plays out like a soap opera, so I'm going to just try to sort of act it out for you. This is Rachel, the more attractive one. This is Leah, the less attractive one, and this is Jacob, okay? So let me just tell you how this goes. It starts, if you were to read the chapter, it starts with Leah, and she says, God's giving me more sons than I know what to do with because he feels bad that I'm not as beautiful as you, she says to Rachel, who says, well, I might be beautiful, but I don't have any kids, and I am really angry at God and at you. And Jacob says, what am I, God? What am I, God, that I can give you children? I have control over this. You know, this is between you and God, he says. So the chapter continues to play out, and she's so upset that she doesn't have any descendants, she says to, take my servant and sleep with her, and maybe I'll get some heirs from her. And he's like, Shazam. So then, let me make sure I'm getting this straight. So then she says, I'm kind of slowing down and giving birth to kids. Take my servant too. And he says, come on, Shazam. So now he has more descendants coming, but wait, this is going to get even crazier. Then Rachel says, where'd you get those mandrakes? Now you have to know that a mandrake is a plant with a purple flower and a tomato-like fruit on it. It was believed that mandrakes were like a aphrodisiac. But the point is that she wanted the mandrakes because she wanted to give birth to her own son. So she sees her son, Reuben, the oldest, coming in. And he's like, hey, mom, I found these mandrakes. Do you want some? She's like, sure. The more mandrakes, the more sons I'll have. And Rachel says, hey, give me some of those mandrakes. And she's like, you already stole my husband. Now you want my mandrakes too? And she says, I'll let you sleep with Jacob tonight if you give me the mandrakes. And she's like, deal. And so she takes the mandrakes and she ends up giving birth to Joseph. Now, the question that I'm asking myself when I'm reading all of this is, where is Jacob when all this is going on? And their wives are bitter. And I mean, reading this story of these two wives, I mean, if that doesn't convince you not to be a Mormon, I don't know what will. All right? I mean, that's the end of Mormonism right there. This is a disaster. And the worst part of the disaster is, where on earth is Jacob? Jacob didn't have to keep neglecting his family. Are you listening? He didn't have to do that. Where is Jacob? Is he at work? Is he on the golf course? Is he on the road? Neglect of family among men is epidemic. Passive when we should be taking action. Weak when we should be strong. Selfish when we should be generous. Distracted when we should be focused. Such a stronghold in the life of Jacob and so many men who work so hard at so many things, but not about the things that matter most. Strongholds blow up through your own decisions. And then, notice, Jacob didn't have to keep bargaining with God. Jacob didn't have to keep neglecting his family. Jacob didn't have to keep deceiving. Chapter 30 is a remarkable account of, starting in verse 25, if you have a paragraph heading, it says Jacob's prosperity. And basically, as soon as Joseph is born, the son of promise, the son who would one day deliver this entire family after being sold as a slave into Egypt, as soon as his Rachel, his precious Rachel, see there the stronghold of favoritism that's been in his family for generations, as soon as that son's born, Jacob's like, we are out of here. I got to build my own family. Now, that's not wrong to get apart from your parents, leave your father and mother, be joined to your wife, Genesis 2:24. Interestingly, Jacob says he's leaving, and Laban announces, this is just remarkable, Laban shows up, verse 27, and says, I have learned by divination. What? I've learned by divination. Think horoscopes, Ouija boards, and psychics, okay? And tarot cards. He went up to one of those little booths somewhere. So he's doing this freaky, occultic thing. And he says, I've learned by divination that the Lord has blessed me because of you. Duh. Could have just looked at a calendar. Things started getting better when he came. Name your wages and I'll give it. Now, Jacob, here comes this stronghold. Jacob should have said, oh, my wages are X. I've been working here for this long, you owe me X. I'll work for this many more years, you owe me Y. X plus Y equals what you owe me, sign here. Or let's call the attorneys, let's get this in writing. But he did not do that. A broad offer from God kept him negotiating. Now a broad offer from his father-in-law will take him right back to cheating again. Even though he was so crushed when he was lied to about Leah and Rachel, now he's going to go do the same thing again. Now, I was with the training center guys this week, and I really wrestled with how to handle this passage. I'm going to let you read it on your own time, but let's just say they got into a breeding war. My sheep, your sheep, most productive, least productive. And Jacob was deceiving Laban to try to get an advantage. And what's remarkable in this, just look up here for a sec. What's remarkable in this is God wanted to bless Jacob. God promised to bless Jacob, but Jacob couldn't get out of his own way. Jacob couldn't stop lying, even though he had no reason to do it anymore. So much so that when you get into the middle of this chapter, in Genesis 31, he says to verse 4, Jacob called Rachel and Leah into the field. Come on, we're out of here. The brothers got jealous. 31:1. Jacob says, we're out of here. 31:4. 6, you know that I have served your father with all my strength, yet your father has cheated me and changed my wages 10 times. Remember what we've been learning? What goes around, here it comes, right back on you. Liars get lied to, cheaters get cheated. I'm not saying that everybody who's had something bad to them did it. I'm saying that everyone whose life has been about doing bad things to others will experience the same before it's over. What he desperately needs is to start thinking differently about God, about himself, about his life, about where blessing comes from, and about where consequences come from, and how God is ruling over it all.
We all have them. They keep us from moving forward and making progress. They're roadblocks that are way more destructive than we'd like to think. And like a walled city at the top of a mountain, they can be extremely hard to overcome. I'm talking about strongholds, those fortified patterns of thinking stubbornly resistant to God's word and his will for your life. Thankfully, you can get victory over them. But it takes more than just wanting to. It takes the power of Jesus Christ.
I love what Paul told the Corinthians. The weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh. They have divine power to destroy strongholds. So whatever has hold of you today, God doesn't want it that way. The ball's in your court. Breaking the cycle begins now. I really want to help you conquer these strongholds.
Get the Conquering Your Strongholds kit today for proven practical teaching from God's Word on this important subject. First, use the Discovering Strongholds booklet to identify the destructive thought and behavior patterns in your life. Then, watch a powerful message from Pastor James that walks you through the process of removing those patterns so that you can move forward into victory. If you're ready to break free from the cycle of sin and defeat, request the Conquering Your Strongholds kit when you support Walk in the Word with any amount. And for a gift of $85 or more, we'll also send you the entire Think Differently series on DVD. These 11 messages further explore how to tear down the strongholds that are keeping you from experiencing all that God has for you. Learn to change your thinking so you can live a new, more victorious life in Christ. Request the Strongholds collection today when you call 800-545-6800 or go online to jamesmacdonald.tv.
Now what's so amazing is verse 11, the angel of God said to me in a dream, Jacob, I said, here I am. He said, lift up your eyes and see all the... And so the story unfolds here of how God said, I have seen all that Laban is doing to you. I am the God of Bethel. Remember that time we spent together? The things I promised you? Now go out from this land. See, God's trying to take care of Jacob, and Jacob won't let God take care of him. That is remarkable. God is trying to take care of Jacob and keep the promises he's made. And Jacob won't let God do it. Now, our time is gone. So notice also that Jacob didn't have to keep avoiding conflict. He didn't have to keep avoiding conflict, but he does. Verse 17 of chapter 31, he arose, he set his sons and his wives on camels, he drove away. Pack up the station wagon, we are out of here. I'm not dealing with this anymore. Like his father and like his grandfather, he's going to go away under cover of darkness. He's going to run from the conflict. That's the way he is. He always deceives. He does what's best for himself, and he can't face straight into any truth exchanges. And so he runs and hides. Well, of course, Laban goes after him. Verse 27, why did you flee secretly and trick me and did not tell me so that I might have sent you away with mirth and songs? Yeah, right. A liar talking to a liar. You didn't permit me to kiss my daughters. Oh, you mean the ones you sold to me? Liars talking to liars. And here comes his real hard attitude. It's in my power, verse 29, to do you harm. But the God of your father spoke to me last night, saying, be careful not to say anything to Jacob, either good or bad. God's still protecting Jacob, even though Jacob is making it so different. What he desperately needs is to start thinking differently about God, about himself, about his life, about where blessing comes from, and about where consequences come from, and how God is ruling over it all. Jacob didn't have to keep deceiving. Jacob didn't have to keep avoiding conflict. And then finally, they grow up in the behavior of loved ones. And I'll tell you just a couple of verses and we're done here. If nothing else scares us into destroying the strongholds in our lives, seeing them in our loved ones should. And so here it is. Jacob's packing up to get out of town, to run away under cover of night. And notice Genesis 31:19, Rachel stole her father's household gods. I mean, pagan family, right? How much spiritual impact is Jacob having on his wife? That she is willing to leave, but she wants to take their gods. What kind of god do you want you can put in a suitcase? We got to take our gods with us. And she steals the gods. And notice there, verse 20, Jacob tricked Laban. Stronghold. It's not changed yet. Verse 25, Laban overtook Jacob, confronts him. We talked about that. But then down to verse 35, Laban ends up in the tent. I'm going to find these idols. I'm going to find them. You have them. My gods, I need them. And he goes in, searching everywhere through the camp, goes into his own daughter's tent. She's sitting on the idols. And he says, get up, I have to find them. And she says to her father, verse 35, let not my Lord be angry that I cannot rise before you, for the way of women is upon me. So he searched, but he did not find the household gods. She was born to a liar. She's married to a liar. And what has she become? Do you see how the strongholds spread? Let me say it again. If nothing else scares us into destroying the strongholds in our lives, then seeing them in our loved ones should. When I was preparing this, it reminded me of, do you remember that guy, Harry Chapin? Do you remember that song, so famous? I don't know if he's famous for many songs, but here's one. Listen to the chorus. And the cats in the cradle and the silver spoon. Little boy, little man on the moon. When you're coming home, daddy, don't know when, but we'll get together then. Yeah, well, it's a catchy chorus, but it's the verses that are impactful. It starts off, my child arrived just the other day. He came to the world in the usual way, but there were planes to catch and bills to pay. He learned to walk while I was away. And he was talking before he knew it. And as he grew, he said, I'm going to be like you, Dad. I'm going to be like you. My son turned 10 just the other day. He said, thanks for the ball, Dad. Come on, let's play. Can you teach me to throw? I said, not today. I got a lot to do. He said, that's okay. And he walked away, but his smile never dimmed. And he said, I'm going to be like him. Yeah, I'm going to be like him. Well, he came from college just the other day. So much like a man, I just had to say, son, I'm proud of you. Can you sit for a while? Shook his head. He said with a smile, what I'd really like, Dad, is to borrow the car keys. See you later. Can I have them, please? Long since retired, my son's moved away. I called him up the other day. I said, I'd like to see you if you don't mind. He said, I'd love to, Dad, if I can find the time. See, my new job's a hassle. The kids have the flu, but it's sure nice talking to you, Dad. It's been sure nice talking to you. And as I hung up the phone, it occurred to me that he'd grown up just like me. My boy was just like me. And if we don't make the hard decisions to think differently, that story, in so many hurtful, destructive ways, is going to be our kids' stories and our grandkids' stories. No, we're on it. The strongholds have now been detected. Next time we're together, we're going to be working on destroying them. Let's pray together. God, thank you for this great privilege to teach your word. Thank you, God, for the strength that you've given so that this weekly progress down this important path might not be interrupted. And I pray for your Holy Spirit to work in our hearts and to convict us of these patterns of thinking, these strongholds that are so destructive. We want to tear them down. Every argument, every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of you, we want to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. So help us as we begin now to work on these strongholds. For your glory in Jesus' name, amen.
That was heavy.
Mm. Yeah, that totally was a heavy message.
Yeah, well, sin is serious, and the consequences of sin are serious, and it's not easy to realize that I'm seeing the results of bad choices that I've made in the mirror of my family who have been impacted by my bad choices. And it's not fun to warn people, but it's a responsibility that we've undertaken for the Lord, and we're trying to do faithfully from the Word of God. You know, sin is serious.
And so is the forgiveness of sins. It's so real, and the redemption we have in Christ is real, and yet the hope we have in Christ is real.
See, I'd love to hear you say that. And the grace of the gospel is real, and people's lives are being changed, and we don't have to stay where we are. What's the whole series called? It's called Think Differently. And as you think differently, you're going to live differently, and your hope is going to become so significant.
Yeah. Watch this.
We all have them. They keep us from moving forward and making progress. They're roadblocks that are way more destructive than we'd like to think. And like a walled city at the top of a mountain, they can be extremely hard to overcome. I'm talking about strongholds, those fortified patterns of thinking stubbornly resistant to God's word and His will for your life. Thankfully, you can get victory over them, but it takes more than just wanting to. It takes the power of Jesus Christ.
I love what Paul told the Corinthians. The weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh. They have divine power to destroy strongholds. So whatever has hold of you today, God doesn't want it that way. The ball's in your court. Breaking the cycle begins now. I really want to help you conquer these strongholds.
Get the Conquering Your Strongholds kit today for proven practical teaching from God's Word on this important subject. First, use the Discovering Strongholds booklet to identify the destructive thought and behavior patterns in your life. Then, watch a powerful message from Pastor James that walks you through the process of removing those patterns so that you can move forward into victory. If you're ready to break free from the cycle of sin and defeat, request the Conquering Your Strongholds kit when you support Walk in the Word with any amount. And for a gift of $85 or more, we'll also send you the entire Think Differently series on DVD. These 11 messages further explore how to tear down the strongholds that are keeping you from experiencing all that God has for you. learn to change your thinking so you can live a new, more victorious life in Christ. Request the Strongholds Collection today when you call 800-545-6800 or go online to jamesmacdonald.tv.
All right, finish up the program today. We got some social media comments here.
Now, I have to just demand that every single person who's watching right now would go to our Facebook page and click like. I mean, I really need you to. Do you know that there are Bible teachers who are friends of mine who have more likes than we do? We can't have this. This is a serious problem. It needs to be corrected.
All right, here's one. We got one from Lance. You're my favorite pastor. You tell it as it is, but you're led by the Holy Spirit.
Well, I pray that that's true.
Yes. Amen. Isn't that awesome?
Amen.
And this one's from Leonard. Thank you, Pastor James. I get a lot of joy from listening to you. God bless you and your family. Mm-hmm. Well, we were included on that one.
That was very nice.
You know, honestly, it is really a kind thing when a person who watches responds through social media and just says, hey, we're out here. Mm-hmm. God's using the ministry in our life, and we want to thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't want to get into this five back. Thank you. But let me just say thank you for taking the time to express your appreciation for what we're investing ourselves in. Yeah. And it's thrilling to know that God's using it in your life.